blueprints in view of the present pandemic, our worthy director, Madam Anuradha Gupta ji, have started a program, that is DSEJ's home classes, which is a small attempt to connect learner with instructor. And I, Dr.Simply Mahajan, chemistry lecturer, presently working in SRML Higher Secondary School, feel privileged to be the part of this program. Today I am going to start class 12 chemistry syllabus, and as you know that there are 16 chapters in chemistry syllabus of class 12, and today I am going to start first chapter of the chemistry subject, that is solid state. Before starting this chapter, I want to introduce some facts that you students, you have already studied in your 11th standard states of matter. And in that chapter, you studied the detailed properties of liquids, gases. Now, in this class, you have to study the detailed properties of solids. So, firstly, the first question is, what do you mean by solid? So solid, it is that state of matter which has definite shape and size, volume, which have definite shape, size and volume, in which constituent particles are tightly packed . Due to this close packing of constituent particles, they show some properties like they have strong intermolecular forces, that forces may be of attraction as well as repulsion. Then they have less intermolecular distance, they are non-compressible. Properties of solid. We have other properties too, but in this chapter you know the main properties of solids, they include such properties. Now next topic is types of solids. We have different types of solids. Solids have been classified mainly into two types. That is crystalline solids, amorphous solids. Crystalline solids are also known as true solids, whereas amorphous solids are also known as pseudo solids or sometimes we also say it as super cooled liquids. In layman's language, if you want to differentiate these two solids, we can take the example of chalk as well as marble. Both have same molecular formula, that is CaCO3. But the difference is that one is crystalline solid and another is amorphous solid. Now the question is, which is crystalline solid and which is amorphous solid? If you see a piece of chalk and a piece of marble, you try to break that. Marble cannot be broken down But chalk can be easily broken down. Why? Because chalk is an example of amorphous solid. And we know that in crystalline solid, which is a true solid, the constituent particles, which I will give you detailed information about the crystalline solids. In true solids, there are strong forces, they are regular arrangement, but in this, there is a irregular arrangement. Because of that, chalk can be easily broken down. On the other hand, if you take marble, which is an example of crystalline solid, cannot be broken down easily. I will show you the detailed differentiation between crystalline solids and amorphous solids. So our next topic is difference between solid crystalline solids and amorphous solids. Some difference between crystalline solids and amorphous solids are as follows. First point is, crystalline solids show regular arrangement of constituent particles in three dimension, whereas amorphous solids do not show regular arrangement. This can be further shown with the help of diagram. If we present crystalline solid in this way, where blue color dot represent one type of ion and red color dot represent other type of ion. Then the structure is like this. Here, this is a cation, then anion, cation, anion, cation, then anion, cation, and likewise. Here, the distance between two ions is equal in every direction, whether we move horizontally or vertically or along z axis. But in case of amorphous solids, there is no regular arrangement. It's like this. So you have observed that there is no regularity or not equal distance between two constituent particles. We can also explain it with the help of a classroom. Suppose we have a situation like in one classroom, the students are arranged in such a way that on one side there is a row of, there are different rows of only boys, and in other side there are different rows of girls. Then we say that there is a regularity in the arrangement of classroom. We can, if we have to find out some particular boy, we have to look only in that side where the boys are sitting. But if we have another classroom where randomly girls and boys are sitting, then if you want to search or look for a particular girl or boy, then you have to look the faces of every student. So that is the example of amorphous solids, and this is where the regular arrangement, where there is a difference or where there is a different row of boys and girls, that shows the arrangement like crystalline solids. Because of this arrangement, these crystalline solids show long range order, whereas
amorphous solids show short range order only. Now, what do you mean by long range order and short range order? It means when we move in a crystalline solid long distance, everywhere the distance between two constant particles is equal. That means it is ordered in a long direction. But in case of amorphous solids, they do not show long range order, because if you observe this crystal, you have seen that along this, up to this distance, the constant particles are possessing same distance. But after that, the distance is minimized and it expands, and downward also sometimes the constant particles are apart from each other, far apart from each other, and in other cases they are close to each other. That means they show order, but up to a small distance, and this is known as short range order. And the part of amorphous solid which show ordered arrangement, like this part, where we observe that this is something like a crystalline solid, there is a regularity, there is a ordered arrangement. This part of amorphous solid is known as crystallite, as it resembles crystalline solids. In some books, the spelling of crystallites is like C, it's like this. And in other it is like this. So crystallite is a part of amorphous solid which show ordered arrangement like that of crystalline solid. Otherwise this type of solids, they show irregularity, they do not possess order, but up to a certain extent, up to a small extent, they show ordered, and that part is known as crystallite. Now next point, because of this arrangement, because their arrangement is in a regular way, they have sharp melting point. However, amorphous solid show a range of they show melting point over a range of temperature. Now what do you mean by these two points, sharp? When we say sharp melting point, it means if you have a solid whose melting point is 54 degrees Celsius, that means that solid will melt only at 54 degrees Celsius, not at 54.1, not below 54. That means sharp melting point. But when we talk about these amorphous solids, they have melting point over a range of temperature. It means if we say that a particular amorphous solid has a melting point, that is 10 degrees Celsius, but that amorphous solid may or may not melt at 10 degrees Celsius. Sometimes it starts melting at 9 degrees Celsius and it goes up to, that means it completely melt up to 11 degrees Celsius. That means its melting point is over a range of temperature, but it has sharp melting point. Now next point is, this point is very very important. Crystalline solid shows anisotropy, and amorphous solid shows isotropy. Now this name, mostly whenever we evaluate the sheets of answer sheets of students, mostly students get confused by this point. They write anisotropy for amorphous and isotropy for crystalline. But crystalline solids are anisotropy and amorphous are isotropy. Now what do you mean by anisotropy? That is, they show different physical properties along different directions, and isotropy means they show same physical properties along different directions. This can also be cleared from this diagram of crystalline and amorphous solids. How? Anisotropy means these crystalline solid physical properties you have already studied, like refractive index, surface tension, viscosity. If we study the surface tension or viscosity or refractive index for a particular crystalline solid in different directions like x, y, z axis, then we have observed that they show different properties in different directions. How? If you move in a crystalline solid along x axis, you will find that there is blue color, then blue, red, blue. Now, if you move towards this axis, so you have observed that there are only red color particles. That means in every direction, if you study a refractive index or any other physical properties, they show different values. Why? Because the constituent particles which come across in a particular direction is different in different direction. However, in this case, if you move in this direction either or in this direction, all show random behavior. Or you can I can also explain this with the help of a particular example. Already I have taken example of a classroom, that crystalline solid is compared to a classroom where there is a separate arrangement for boys and girls. So when you have to search for a particular boy or a particular girl, you have to look only on that side where the girls are sitting or where the boys are sitting. That means in every direction you have different type of individuals, either boys or either girl. But in crystalline solid, where there is a mixture of girls and boys in a particular room, and you have to search for a particular girl or particular student, then you have to observe in every direction, and in every direction you have same type of environment. That means you find same type of crowd, that is boy, girl, boy, mixture of that. So this, in this way they show isotropy and they show anisotropy. Now next point, if you cut crystalline solids with a sharp knife, you find a clean cleavage. They show a clean cleavage with sharp knife, whereas they don't show clean cleavage. That means if you cut crystalline solid with the help of a sharp knife, you find that cleavage is very clean, there is a smooth surface. Whereas in case of amorphous solid, they do not show clean cleavage. We can observe this in case of glass or rubber. If you cut the rubber with the help of a knife, you have observed that when you touch the surface of that rubber, cut rubber, you find there is some roughness on the surface. Whereas if you cut any crystal with the help of a sharp knife, they show clean surface. Now sixth is examples. Under crystalline solids, we have NaCl, ionic solids, all ionic solids, KCl, quartz, etc. And under amorphous solids, we have rubber, glass, etc. I have already told you that amorphous solids are pseudo-solids, or they are also known as supercooled liquids. And glass is an example which show the properties of supercooled liquid. How? Have you observed window pane or glass pane, which is very very old? Have you observed that the surface of that window pane is thin at the top, whereas thick at the bottom? Why? Because the glass is a particular example of supercooled liquid which melts over a period of time. Also, we observed this in case of mirrors. We have observed that when we brought a mirror from the market, it shows clean image.
Whereas after some time, like you can say after 2-3 years, that mirror will not show clean image. Why? Because that mirror is an example of supercooled liquid and melts with the passage of time. And when it melts, the surface of mirror at the top becomes thin and at the bottom it becomes thick. Because of that, image is not formed clearly. So this is all about crystalline solid and amorphous solid. In this chapter, we only deal with crystalline solid. Why? Because it is a true solid. So in this chapter, we will do the detailed study of crystalline solids. The topic is types of crystalline solids. Crystalline solids have been divided into four main classes. And we will study it with the help of a table. Ionic solids, metallic solids, then molecular solids, and covalent solids. Covalent is also known as network solid. We study these four types of solids with the help of a table where we differentiate all these types. So first point is intermolecular forces, or we can say constituent particles. In ionic solids, constituent particles are ions that may be cations or anions. In metallic solids, constituent particles are metal atoms, or you can also say, because when we observe the structure of metallic crystal, there is the presence of positively charged kernels and immobile electrons. So we can also say that constituent particles of metallic solids are positively charged kernels and mobile electrons. In molecular solids, we have atoms or molecules. In covalent solids, we have atoms, especially which type of atoms? Here in metallic solids, we have metal atoms, and here we have non-metallic atoms. Now the second point is this force of interaction. The bond with the help of which constituent particles in these solids are bonded, that is force of interaction. In case of ionic solids, the force of interaction is ionic bond. In metallic solids, it is metallic bond. In molecular solids, we have different molecular forces, like it may be van der Waals forces, it may be hydrogen bond. So we say molecular forces like van der Waals forces or hydrogen bond. And in covalent solids, we have covalent bond. Now third is electrical conductivity. In case of ionic solids, they show conductivity only in their molten or fused state. That means they show
poor conductivity in solid state, but in molten or fused state they show electrical conductivity. So we can write here they show conductivity only in their molten or fused state. In metallic solids also show electrical conductivity, and their conductivity is very very high. That means their conductivity is high. Why? Because in case of metallic solids, metal atoms are present, and you know that the definition of metal atom. Metal atoms are those atoms which have a tendency to lose electrons. That means they have electrons every time, and electrons are moving continuously, so they show high conductivity. When we see these molecular solids, they also show conductivity. They show conductivity which is low. And covalent solids also show, exception is there, but they show low conductivity with the exception of graphite. Because graphite is a good conductor of electricity. So generally they show low conductivity, but we have an exception of graphite. Now fourth property is their melting point. Melting point. Now ionic solids, they show high melting point. Metallic solids, they also show high melting point. And this depends on nature of bonds. Then molecular solids, they show low melting point. Whereas covalent solids, they show very high melting point. Now next point is this nature. We see ionic solids, they are hard but brittle. Metallic solids are also hard. Molecular, they are soft. And covalent solids, they are also show hardness, but we have exceptions also, and we are not discussing all the exceptions, but they show hardness along with some exceptions. Then we have examples. Under ionic solids, we have all ionic crystals like NaCl, KCl, cesium chloride, etc. Metallic solids, we have all metals and alloys. Then molecular solids, we have I2, solid carbon dioxide, then ice. Then covalent solids, we have diamond, graphite, silicates, etc. So these are the points with the help of which we can differentiate all these four types of crystalline solids. Thank you so much.